okay. Again, we will state this. Okay. Function f in the interval I is set to be number one. strictly increasing if f dash x is strictly greater than 0, right? Number 2, f is said to be just increasing function, okay, if f dash x is greater than or equals to 0, okay. Third one, it is strictly decreasing if f dash x is strictly greater than less than 0, and if it is just called as decreasing if f dash x is less than or equals to 0. Okay, so this is by applying derivative you are able to check whether a function is strictly increasing, strictly decreasing, or decreasing function. Okay, so let me take a few examples. Okay. Check whether fx equals to 3x minus 7 increasing or decreasing on the set of real numbers. Okay. Check whether the function fx equals to 3x minus 7 is increasing or decreasing on the set of real numbers. Now your interval is negative infinity to positive infinity. Okay, so when I say real numbers, it means set of all real numbers, and in interval you take negative infinity to positive infinity. So a real number means it is this set of all real numbers, that is negative open interval negative infinity to positive infinity. Okay. Now here, this is how you are going to do, okay? Now, for every function, it's not possible for us to draw the graph, okay? If graphically also, you can, if you are able to draw the graph of all the functions, then graphically you can say whether the function is increasing or decreasing, strictly increasing or strictly decreasing. But it's not possible for us to draw the graph of the function every time, okay? So, now what you are going to do is, using the derivative, we will try to check whether the function is increasing or decreasing, or strictly increasing or strictly decreasing. So here you are given fx is equals to 3x minus 7. So first you differentiate this. So f dash x, what do you get? You get this is 3. Derivative of 3x is 3. Okay. Derivative of 7 is 0. So you just get 3, which means now f dash x is equals to 3, which is always positive, is it? Right? It's always positive for all real numbers. So whatever x you take, it will be always 3, which is positive, which is strictly greater than 0. So therefore, you will say fx is strictly increasing function. Is that clear? So this is how you're going to do, right? Okay, if I take another example, say if I write minus 5x squared plus 5, if I write this, okay, so then what is your fx here? In this case it is negative 5x squared plus 5. So first find out f dash x. So you get here, this is okay, you just write x, not x squared. So then we get here negative 5, is it right? So this is strictly less than 0, right? So whatever x you take here, okay, so for all x this function is always negative, right? So which means derivative is always less than 0 for all the values of x in the real number. So therefore you will say that fx is strictly decreasing function. So this is how we apply derivative, right? Now it's quite simple for us to check whether a function is strictly increasing and decreasing if a function is either increasing or if it is decreasing, right? but for neither increasing neither decrease neither increasing nor decreasing function, right? So in that, in such functions, okay, within that interval, the function is increasing as well as it is decreasing. Okay, so in such case, how we have to find out is now please keep note of all the things I had written here. Okay, so right now you may feel you are clear with the concept, but later you may forget. Okay, so therefore you keep a note, so whenever there is a need, you can just recall them using with the help of this note. Okay, okay, now I will show you how we are going to apply derivative, okay, to check whether a function is neither for nature of the function which is neither increasing nor decreasing in the interval AB, right? In the interval AB, okay, let me take a function neither increasing nor decreasing. Now you know that neither increasing nor decreasing means in that interval the function is increasing as well as it is decreasing, right? So if I take this function, first let me just take a very simple example, okay? So you can see at this function is increasing as well as it is decreasing, right? So therefore this is an example of a function which is neither increasing nor decreasing, right? So any function which is neither increasing nor decreasing, you will get, now listen carefully, for every function which is neither increasing nor decreasing, you will get at least one point within the interval, right, at which the function is changing its behavior, which means now starting from A, the function is strictly increasing, right? Okay, by reaching at this point C, by reaching at this point C, up to C, when you go from here A to C, the function is increasing, and by the time you reach C, right, the function starts decreasing. Now from this interval, the function starts decreasing, is it right? So such point, okay, at which the function is changing its behavior, okay, so at C the function is changing its behavior. Earlier it was increasing, then by reaching C it starts decreasing, so it's changing its behavior. So a point at which the function is changing its behavior, this point is called as critical point. So you have to remember this, right? Critical point, is that clear? So first you have to know what do we mean by critical point. So critical point is any point within the interval at which the function is changing its behavior or the function is changing its nature, right? So earlier on the left hand side of C, the function is strictly increasing. By reaching C, the function starts decreasing. So C is called as the critical point. So any increasing and decreasing function, right, you will get at least one critical point within that interval, right? So this is one example, okay. Similarly, if I consider another function, let me take, if your function is like this, right? Now you tell me what type of function it is. Is it increasing or decreasing or strictly increasing or strictly decreasing or neither increasing nor decreasing? So you will say it's neither increasing nor decreasing, because you will see that the function is here it's increasing, here it's decreasing, then again it's increasing, then it's decreasing. So therefore this function is neither increasing nor decreasing, right? So now here in this case, right, how about the critical points? Now you know the meaning of critical point. Critical point is any point at which the function is changing its behavior. So earlier, from start from here, it's increasing. By reaching here, let me take this as C1, it starts decreasing, right? So A to C1, the function was increasing, then here it starts decreasing, then by reaching at C2, okay, so C1 and C2, within this interval the function is decreasing. By reaching C2, the function starts increasing, right? And then at C3, the function starts decreasing, is it? So we get here three critical points. So all these points are called as critical points. So simply, critical point means any point within the interval at which the function is changing its behavior. So these are the three critical points. Okay, so this is how we define critical point. So for any function which is neither increasing nor decreasing, you will get at least one critical point. You will get, okay, so in the previous example, in the previous graph, we had taken a neither increasing nor decreasing function in which we get only one critical point, right? This is again an example of neither increasing nor decreasing function. in which we got three critical points, right? So critical point means any point at which the function is changing its behavior. So if a function is neither increasing nor decreasing, then you will get at least one critical point. Okay, now what happens is, for a function, if you get any critical point, then it means the function is neither increasing nor decreasing. Because if a function is strictly increasing, then the function is no way changing its behavior. The graph goes on increasing, right? So there you will not get any critical point, right? Similarly, for the decreasing, strictly decreasing function, you will not get any critical point, okay? Similarly, for increasing function, the function is increasing and then it goes constant. At that time, we don't say that the function is changing its behavior. No, okay? So the function is increasing, then it goes constant, and then it starts increasing. So then the function is no way changing its behavior, right? So even though it's changing from increasing to going constant, but we will not say that that point is the critical point. Remember, critical point means the function is increasing and then it starts decreasing. That point is called as the critical point, okay? Now, we'll try to see one pattern over here. At the critical point, okay, if you draw the tangent, if you draw a tangent at the critical point, then you will see that all the tangents at the critical points will be parallel to x-axis. It always happens, right? So from the critical point, when you draw the tangent to that curve, okay, that the tangent will be always parallel to x-axis, right? And we know that the slope of the tangent which are parallel to x-axis is always equals to zero. So therefore, the slope of the tangents, which is actually the derivative of the at these points, are equal to zero, right? So for the critical point, okay, at critical point, f dash x always equals to zero, right? Because from the critical point, when you draw the tangent is parallel to x-axis, and the slope of the x-axis is equals to zero. So therefore, critical point, when you draw the tangent, which is actually the derivative. So derivative means it is the slope of the tangent, is it? So when you are first introduced to the derivative using first principle method was derived, okay, how it was derived? It was derived using the slope of the tangent, taking a secant, and then secant, you convert that into a tangent. So the tangent, slope of the tangent is considered as the derivative. If you remember that, you had done in class 11, okay? So here, this tangent, slope of this tangent is equals to zero because it is parallel to x-axis. So therefore, at all the critical points, derivative will be always equals to zero. Is that clear? Okay. Okay, now I'll take one example and we will try to solve, okay? If a function is strictly increasing or strictly decreasing, then it's quite simple. You just find out f dash x and it will be, you will get a constant over there. So if it is either positive or negative. So if it is positive, then you will say that the function is strictly increasing. If it is negative, then you will say that the function is strictly decreasing, right? But in case if a function is neither increasing nor decreasing, then how we are going to solve it? We'll take one example, okay? Okay, now we will take one example, okay? Find the intervals in which the function fx equals to 4x cubed minus 6x squared minus 72x plus 30 is strictly increasing and strictly decreasing, okay? So which means in an interval, if the function is increasing and decreasing, then the function is neither increasing nor decreasing. So you should know, know that when a function is of this type, neither increasing nor decreasing, then you will get at least one critical point. So you have to remember that, right? So find the intervals means you have to find if the interval is not given, then you have to consider your interval as negative infinity to positive infinity. Set of all real numbers is to be taken as your interval when the interval is not given, if when the interval is not specified in the question, right? Okay, so for all such type of question, okay, if you are asked to find the interval in which the function is increasing and decreasing, then first of all, the first step you have to do is you have to find the critical point. Because if you know the critical point, then you will know that at what point the function is changing its behavior. So which means on the left of the critical point, the function behavior is either increasing, then it starts decreasing, or first it was decreasing and then it starts increasing. It is the only possibility we have, right? So therefore, for all such type of question, the first step you have to do is you have to find the critical point, right? Okay, -72x +30. So first of all, you will find out f dash x, because to find the critical point, you know that f dash x is equals to 0 at the critical point. So you need to find out the f dash x first of all. So that is 12x square minus 12x minus 72, right? So this is 4 3 is a 12x square, 6 2 is a 12x, and minus 72. Derivative of 30 is 0, okay? So I get here f dash x is equals to, now from this you can take out 12 common. Since you can do that, therefore you are taking out common. Not necessarily you have to do it every time, okay? So here I'm left with x square minus x minus 6. Is it 12 5 is 60, 12 6 is 72. Okay, so I get this, right? So now you will do this. For critical points, okay, what do you have? F dash x is equals to 0. Is it, right? For critical point, f dash x is equals to 0. So this is 12 into x square minus x minus 6 is equals to 0, right? So now you need to solve this. So you keep 12 as it is. You just find out this. So this is using middle term splitting, you have x square plus 2x minus 3x minus 6 is equals to 0. That is 12 into x plus 2, and from here you can take out negative 3 common, so that is x plus 2. Okay, this is equals to 0. So you have 12 into x plus 2 x minus 3 is equals to 0, right? So now you look here, when you're saying that product of 12 into x plus 2 into x minus 3 is equals to 0, then either one of them has to be 0, right? So this implies, okay, I'll do it here. After this, you complete here. So this implies either x is equals to, now for this term to be 0, you have to get the product is equals to 0. So 12 is a non-zero term, it cannot be 0. So either this has to be 0 or this has to be 0, right? So to make this 0, x is equals to negative 2, and to make this 0, x is equals to 3. So this is how you find the solution. So this is either x is equals to 2 and x is equals to 3. When you take x is equals to negative 2, this term becomes 0. So this whole equation is satisfied. When you take or x is equals to 3, so then 3 minus 3, this term becomes 0. So then this equation is satisfied, right? So for this equation, you get these two solutions. Is that clear, right? So which means these are the two critical points. Okay, now when I say that negative 2 is the critical point, right, always you take the smaller number on the left hand side. You take negative 2, 3. Instead of taking 3 and negative 2, you write negative 2 and 3. Always take the smaller number on the left hand side, because we have to take it on the number line, right? Okay, now you look here, I get these two points, negative 2 and 3, right? Now my whole interval is given as set of all real numbers, so you have to consider negative infinity to positive infinity as your whole interval, within which we get only two critical points. Critical point we get only two, which means this function throughout the real number, it is changing its behavior at only two points, right? Negative 2 and 3. Now when I say that negative 2 is the critical point, then there are two possibilities. That is, either the function is it is increasing like this, by reaching negative 2 it starts decreasing. This may be one possibility, right? Other way is, right, or the function is decreasing and then it starts increasing by reaching 2. This is one possibility, or this is one possibility, right? So negative 2, if you say that it is critical point, then either the function was earlier increasing, then it starts decreasing, or the function is earlier decreasing and then it starts increasing. So these are the two possibilities when we say that negative 2 is the critical point, right? So corresponding to that, you may get like this. Since again negative 3 is a critical point, so therefore it's increasing and then by reaching 3 it starts decreasing. This may be one possibility, or earlier it was decreasing and then by reaching 3 it starts increasing, right? So these are the only possibilities you have, okay? Right? So now you have to check, right? Within this interval, the function is increasing or decreasing and so on. So we have to now check the nature, okay? So for that, what you are going to do is, now you recall the definition of increasing, decreasing, strictly increasing, strictly decreasing. We had defined all that, right? So first you divide this into intervals you get, okay? So what you get, we get here three sub intervals. One is negative infinity to negative 2, right? Other interval we get is negative 2 to 3, right? And then we get 3 to infinity. Okay, so we get these three sub intervals. Okay, so you will divide the given interval into three sub intervals, right? And then what you are going to do is you are going to check the sign of f dash x at this at a point at this interval. So what is your f dash x? You always write the simplified form of the f dash x, which we get here. This is 12 into x plus 2 into x minus 3, is it? You check it here, right? And then you here at this third column, you check the sign of f dash x, okay? Now what you will do is, within this interval, you take any one point. Now negative infinity to negative 2, you can take negative 3, negative 4, negative 5 and so on. Whatever, just take one point, okay? We know that if the function is increasing in this interval, then f dash x is positive. You remember we had stated that, okay? If the function is decreasing, then f dash x is negative. So we are going to use it over here. So I will take negative 3 from here. I will take negative 3 from here and I will put it here. So what do you get? F dash of negative 3, you take it here. So then you get here 12. Okay. Okay, 12 into, this is negative 3, right? So negative 3 plus 2, what do you get? This is negative 1 into, what do you get here? This is negative 6, right? Now you don't have to calculate the actual value. Just you look at this sign, okay? This term is positive, or you can just write this. Or else you can write like this. 12 is a positive term, right? When you put negative 3 over here, negative 3 plus 2, which means you get negative 1. So that is a negative term. And here when you put negative 3, again this is negative term. Negative 3 minus 3 is negative 6, right? So this is a positive term. When you put negative 3 here, this is negative term, this is a negative term. So you check the sign. Positive, negative, 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 positive. So this is a positive term, right? So sign of f dash x is positive if you take any point within this interval, which means the function is increasing in this interval, is it? If the sign of f dash x is positive, it means within that interval the function is increasing. So it's increasing. Now if you take any one point from here, negative 2 to 3, you can take 0, right? 0 means this term is already positive, okay? 0 means this is also positive. 0 plus 2 is 2, that is positive. 0 minus 3 is negative 3, and this term is negative, right? So positive, positive, negative, negative, sorry, positive, 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 negative, negative, right? Okay, now you take one point from here, 3 to infinity, you take 4, right? 4, 5, 6, 7, any point you can take. So if I take 4, so 12 is already a positive term, positive, 12 is a positive term. 4 plus 2, which is also positive, right? 4 minus 3 is 1, which is again a positive term. So this term is a positive term, right? So you can see the function is increasing in the interval negative infinity to negative 2 and 3 to infinity. So within these two intervals, the function is strictly increasing. And in the interval negative 2 to 3, the function is strictly decreasing, right? So you can now answer them A, right? Fx is strictly increasing in, now you can take the intervals, negative infinity, negative 2, union, you can write these two intervals, okay? So you can take union, 3 to infinity, and B, fx is strictly decreasing in negative 2 to 3. So this is the complete solution to this question, right? So all types of question from this topic will be like this: finding the intervals in which the function is strictly increasing or strictly decreasing. Okay, so I'll just quickly recall this. So the first step you have to do is you will differentiate the function, right? And then you will equate it with zero to get the critical point. So if a function is neither increasing nor decreasing, then you will get at least one critical point, right? So you will find the critical point, okay? And we got these two critical points, negative 2 and 3, right? So then you now divide the given interval into sub-intervals. So negative infinity to 2. Now be careful while you're taking the interval. That's why I told you, you take the smaller number on the left-hand side always. If you write 3 over here, then negative infinity to 3, 3 to negative 2, then it's a wrong way of taking the interval. Interval means left-hand side always has to be smaller, right? So we get 3 sub-intervals, and then from each interval, you will take one point, arbitrary point, and you check the sign of f dash x. And from that, okay, you can see whether the function is increasing or decreasing in that interval. So this is how you're going to do it. Is that clear? Increasing and decreasing. So always for any type of question on this topic, if you're asked to check the nature of the function in the interval, then first you will differentiate the function. That is the first step. Then you equate it with zero, equate derivative with zero to get the critical points. Whatever critical points you get, okay, you will make sub intervals, and then in each sub interval you take one point and you check the sign of f dash x. If f dash x is positive at that point, then within that interval the function is strictly increasing. If f dash x is negative at the point you had taken from that interval, then the function is strictly decreasing in that interval. Is that clear? So this is how you're going to do it. And all such type of questions, okay, it comes for 4 marks, and it is frequently asked in the exam. So please, you should be very try to be clear with the concept of increasing and decreasing. Okay, so first you will go through the definitions of increasing and decreasing which we had stated, okay, and then how we apply derivative in checking whether a function is increasing or decreasing function, right? Okay, so this is the one of the application of derivatives where we can check the increasing nature of the function, right? Okay, so today you will do exercise 6.2. okay, so 6.2, all the questions are on this topic, finding the intervals in which the function is increasing and decreasing. And before doing exercise 6.2, right, there are a few examples given before this exercise. So first you go through all these examples, and together with the solutions given in the textbook, you try to solve it by yourself, try to understand the concept, try to understand how it is to be solved, okay? And then you will start exercise 6.2. This is one important, very important topic from the unit calculus, okay? And it's quite simple also. I will repeat it one more time, okay? If you're asked to find the intervals in which the function is strictly increasing and strictly decreasing, what you have to do is first you will differentiate the function, equate it with zero to get the critical points. After obtaining the critical points, then you divide the interval into sub-intervals by taking the critical points, okay? And within each sub-interval, you take one point and check the sign of f dash x at this point. And if you get positive f dash x at that point, then which means within that interval the function is increasing, strictly increasing. If you get f dash x to be negative at that point, then in that interval the function is strictly decreasing. So this is how you will check. It's quite simple, okay? So before doing the exercise 6.2, okay, there are a few examples given before that. So first you will try to solve it together with the solutions given in the textbook, and try to understand how it is to be done, right? And then you will start exercise 6.2. Okay, so with this today I will stop here, and I'll see you in the next class with a new topic. Until then, you take care and stay safe. Thank you.